Welcome to CBJ in 30.
I'm sure this will be a real bonding experience. Maybe one day, one of you will even write a book about it in jail.
You give us 30 minutes, and we'll give you all you want to know about your Columbus Blue Jackets in the NHL.
Okay, guys, show us what you got.
Now here's your host, who has a few opinions of his own.
Well, la-dee frickin' da!
Bob McElligott.
It's over.
I remember one time as a kid, I was at a wedding reception. I was probably anywhere from 8 to 10 years old. And at this wedding reception, all my cousins and second cousins were there. And I didn't see them very often. They all lived in the city. We lived in the country. And the only time that you got to see them was at a big gathering like this. And I remember that there was a playground behind the reception hall. And we were out in the playground all day, going down the slides, on the seesaw, running around, just having a great time all evening at this reception. And then eventually, my parents and grandparents came up and they said, it's time to go. And we got in the car to go back to my grandmother's house, and I was crying. I was crying because I had so much fun being around my cousins. And I said, why do we have to go home? And my grandmother looked at me and said, all good things must come to an end. And guess what? That's what happened to the Blue Jackets last night in Washington, D.C. Welcome to CBJ in 30. I'm your host, Bob McElligott. I wish this were a live show. If this were a live call-in show right now, I would offer a pair of tickets if you could name the artist of the song that's playing, Sad Eyes. I would offer those tickets, but it's not a live show, and I'm not offering the tickets because you would think it's the Bee Gees or Andy Gibb. No, Robert John in Sad Eyes. Although I was asking myself after that selection, because I thought it was the right selection. But then as I started to think a little bit more about it, I'm wondering if there wasn't another direction that I could have gone. Maybe a more positive direction. And then I thought, you know what? It's your show. You can do whatever the heck you want to. So you don't have to have just one lead-in song. You can have more than one lead-in song. And that is the best way to really attack this today. Because you're sad. But then when you take a moment, you find out that you're happy and that you should be very proud to be a fan of the Columbus Blue Jackets.
And if it's bad, don't let it get you down. You can take it. And if it hurts, don't let them see you cry. You can make it. Hold your head up.
Should hold your head up. Your team just accomplished something that only one other team in the history of the National Hockey League has accomplished, winning 16 straight games. The 1992-93 Penguins did it one better at 17 games, but after that, it's the Columbus Blue Jackets, and that's the way it's going to stay, maybe for a long time. Maybe for a long, long time. What this group of players and coaches have done has been remarkable. And it shouldn't be tainted by a 5-0 loss in Washington. That's the way that these types of streaks end. I said to Jody Shelley about a week ago, and it was a game where the Blue Jackets didn't play very well, and they got a win. And I said to him, you know, when this thing ends, we're going to lose like 7-0. And he agreed. And it wasn't 7, but it was 5. Was it ugly? Only the latter part of it was ugly last night. But hold your head up because your team has accomplished something only one other team in the history of the league has accomplished. Your team has come out in the most competitive division in the National Hockey League, the Metropolitan Division, and has risen to the top of the division. And it's a tight race, and they're going to have to work their butts off to stay where they are. There's no doubt about that. But look, they are in the conversation. Many other years, if the rest of the division had played like they are, the Blue Jackets would be left in the dust. They're not in the dust. They are creating the dust. Everyone is behind them. And that is what you need to be proud of. And for John Tortorella, the head coach of this team, who doesn't ever go into the dressing room after a game, or very seldom anyway, he's told me before that when you go in there, you run the risk of saying something stupid. You let your emotions get a hold of you. You might say something after a loss that you don't really mean, and then it's going to throw everything out of whack. But last night, there was a loss, and he went into the dressing room, and here's why.
Yeah, I just addressed the team. I usually don't go in the room, win or lose. All year long, I haven't been in there. But I'd be remiss, like I told him, if I didn't. That is one hell of a run by a hockey team. And they should feel really good about it. Quite honestly, I thought the first 30 minutes, we were a good hockey club. We played well. We couldn't find a way on Holpe. Made some great saves at key times, and then we kind of lost ourselves. But I'm proud of the team. Well, we're a good hockey team. They'll get a day off tomorrow. We'll get whacking at it against New York the next day.
Here's something I haven't said for a long, 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 long time. It was a tough night for Sergei Bobrovsky last night. He wound up getting pulled from the game after giving up the fifth goal. But, it's going to happen. There are times when it's all going to fall apart. And that's what happened last night for the Blue Jackets. Once it started to go south, it all started to go south. But John Tortorella was certainly not blaming Sergei Bobrovsky for what happened last night. As a matter of fact, Torts admitted that maybe he's played Bob a little bit more than he normally would have.
I think I stretched my goaltender a little bit because of this. I felt I had to with Bob. I think it kind of changed up my scheduling with our goalies because of this. I don't think Bob would want to be taken out in this type of situation, but the athletes sometimes don't know what's best for them. So I can get back to kind of just looking at our situation with the season and figure out the goaltending situation, which is very important, that I think is going to be very important for us, the decisions we make there as we go through the second half of the year. And live through it. I'm excited that they had an opportunity to enjoy this part of it and go through that run. But now we go back to work here and leave this alone.
Hey, I'm not trying to create something that doesn't exist here by any means, but I've got to point this out. Throughout that entire talk about the goaltending situation, he did not mention Curtis McElhaney's name once. Now, Curtis McElhaney has won a couple of big games for this team so far this season. But he didn't mention him by name. Does that mean anything? Maybe it doesn't. But he said the goaltending situation. Let's go back to training camp. And let's remember that there was somewhat of a competition. There was supposed to be a competition to see who was going to be the backup for Sergei Bobrovsky. Jonas Korpisalo wound up getting injured, and that ended the competition. Curtis McElhaney has been here. He's been a true pro. He's been great. As I said, he's won some really big games for this team. Just look at the games against the Arizona Coyotes. Look at the games against the Los Angeles Kings. I mean, he has been huge for this franchise. However, I find it odd that his name didn't get mentioned there. Does that mean that there is still the possibility that a Korpisalo or even an Anton Forsberg could come up? Because here's what you can do. You can do this. You could bring up another goaltender. You could actually scratch Sergei Bobrovsky and have Curtis McElhaney back up whoever the other guy is that starts. You can do that. Just manipulate the roster to make it work in your favor. And I'm not saying any of this is going to happen. I'm not. The only reason I'm pointing it out is because if it does happen, this is a moment that I'm going to look back to and say, oh, right there. It was there. We should have heard it right there. I did hear something, or maybe I heard nothing. We'll find out as we go down the line. So don't start tweeting that Bobby Mack says that there's a backup goaltender controversy. Bobby Mack says Jonas Korpisalo is going to be starting. Bobby Mack says Anton Forsberg's coming up to make. Don't say any of that because that's not what I'm saying. All I'm saying is I'm pointing out the fact that there's something fishy about that thing. And then again, maybe there's not. And we'll find out in the weeks to come. Do you want to know what I hope personally? I'll tell you exactly what I hope personally, and this is not against Anton Forsberg. It's not against Jonas Korpisalo because I like both of those guys. I respect them. Korpisalo was great for this franchise last year when Bobrovsky was injured. But here's what I really hope. I hope Curtis McElhaney can go in there every 3 to 5 games and put on a good performance and get the Blue Jackets a win, because he is a quality individual. He has not made any waves whatsoever in the time that he has been here. He goes out, he does his job, he does it in practice, he does it when he's called upon to do it in a game. He made a great save against Alex Ovechkin late last night when he came on a relief in the third period. I mean, Ovechkin's trying to bury a goal. He started the night 5 points shy of 1,000, and he's trying to shoot the lights out in the third period after they're up 5-0. And Curtis made a really, really good save on him. So don't take this as I'm an anti-Curtis McElhinney. I'm a very pro-Curtis McElhinney guy, believe me. But I'm just pointing out that either John Tortorella just didn't think to put any names into that conversation, or maybe he did it on purpose. I don't know. He's a calculating individual. We've already figured that out, right? I mean, there's a method to his madness in everything. So that's the only reason that I go, is there something there? And I hope there's absolutely nothing there whatsoever. But if I don't point it out today and something happens 3 weeks from now and I come back and I say, you know what, I knew that on January 6th, well, then I look like I'm trying to be smartest guy in the room when I'm the dumbest person on the planet. So that's the only reason I point it out. So please don't start controversies and tweeting and sending each other emails and blogging or whatever. Don't do any of that. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, put a little check mark here and see if we go back to that point at some time in the future. That's it. Simple as that. So the Blue Jackets lose. Power play, no good last night. Braden Holtby was fantastic. Let's be honest. Braden Holtby was outstanding in last night's game. There was a puck that Brandon Saad had on his stick in the first minute of play. He had a lot of net to shoot at. He's trying to go short side, a little bit off balance when he's taking the shot, and he misses the net. In my opinion, if that puck goes in the net in the first minute of the first period, you have stunned the crowd, you have stunned the Washington Capitals, you have built momentum for yourself, and maybe that game plays out a little bit differently. But it doesn't matter what could have happened if this would have occurred or that would have occurred. Nothing occurred. It was time for the streak to end, and the streak, indeed, came to an end. I told you yesterday, on this show, I told you that I felt like Han Solo all day yesterday.
I got a bad feeling about this.
Yeah, and then just like that line from the trash compactor, the walls started to close in later on last night. You know, yesterday I gave you a whole bunch of reasons why the Washington Capitals should have been geared up for the Blue Jackets. I told you that, you know, they had lost twice to the Blue Jackets, and the last time the Blue Jackets played in Washington, they felt they got screwed on a penalty call. They did, but you know, that was partly their fault. So they felt that they were owed something a little bit better. The fact that they have been the President's Trophy winner, they have been the hunted, and yesterday they were the hunter, and there is a lot less pressure on the hunter than there is on the hunted. I told you all of that, but you know what I forgot to mention? The biggest threat to the Blue Jackets yesterday was a guy that has been a threat to the Blue Jackets for a long, long time. Remember, years ago, or a long time ago in a league that's right here, the Blue Jackets were trying desperately at times to create a rivalry with the Nashville Predators. And who was the guy standing behind the bench of the Nashville Predators, a Predators team that won almost every home game they played against the Blue Jackets year after year after year after year? Remember when we used to go in there and no matter what the building was called, would always have to say the Blue Jackets haven't won here in their last 8 trips, 10 trips, 12 trips, whatever it was. Who was the guy? Who was the guy that was there that was also at last night's game? Yeah, you've got it. Barry Trotz, the head coach of the Washington Capitals. His team figured out a way to knock off the 16-game-in-a-row winners last night, and he is a big part of that. He's a great architect and motivator, and I'm sure he had a big hand in that. You know, and he was always called Darth Vader here, that hence the music, but he's a great guy. He really is a great guy, and he had his team ready to go last night, and his team was the winner. Well, the Blue Jackets had some good things to say last evening after the game was over. I thought they handled defeat with grace.
Grace! She passed away 30 years ago.
Now, of course, the next step is going to be handling getting back on the ice and coming up with another win. But let's start at the top and hear from the captain, Nick Foligno.
It's tough when you have it that close, but then, you know, you go back to what we've accomplished here. 16 wins is a heck of a lot of wins in this league, and it's a hard league to win in, so there's a lot of pride in this room too. So I think we're going to treat it like any other game. When you win, you enjoy it, and then you get ready for the next one. When you lose, you think about it, and you get ready for the next one. That's what we're doing here.
Nick, how disappointing was it to have the opportunities and not being able to close? Because had a bounce gone one way or the other,
yeah,
it might have been a different game.
Well, that's what we talked about even in the room. It took a performance like Holpe to probably knock us off. I mean, things were just hitting him, and then we had chances, glorious chances, that we sent him to shoot into him, or even shots that were through screens and just somehow swallow him up. So credit to him. He played outstanding tonight. And you know, a lot of those times those pucks were bouncing off or going in for us. So it's just one of those games where it wasn't, and that's the difference.
And their penalty kill also seemed to do a pretty good job on your power play.
Yeah, and that was, you know, that's been a big momentum booster for our club, and just tonight it didn't get us going. We just didn't have enough, you know, there to, you know, I think a little bit was battle level, and a little bit of it was just luck too. I mean, there were some plays that we had that we just didn't execute on, so I think we can get better in that department, but that's been a thing that's been real good for us all year long.
And with a young team, everything's a learning experience. What did you learn through the streak? What did you learn about the way it ended, and what will you carry forward?
How to carry ourselves in pressure situations, and also, you know, what it feels like to win and to expect to win every time you step on the ice. And I think that's something that's hasn't been the case here in this team for a long time, and we're building that culture, that identity that we talk about, but it's how we go about our business and how we play the game, and that was our bread and butter really for the whole streak, or past 16 games, is we just played a consistent style of game, and it just got away from us tonight.
What did Torts, I know, doesn't rarely come into the locker room after games. What did he say to you guys, and how was he?
Yeah, he just said, be proud of what we've accomplished here. Let's not sulk. I mean, this is an unbelievable you know, achievement by this club, especially from where we were a year ago and what people expected out of us. So enjoy it, but let's get ready to get back to work. You know, this is a good opportunity for us to learn from it and get back to, you know, it's a great opportunity now to play another divisional game on Saturday, and we're looking forward to that.
What he says about getting back to work cannot be just rhetoric for this team. It has to be their mantra. They've got today off. They have all day to think about what they've done for the past month and a half. When they show up tomorrow morning, they have to be ready to beat the New York Rangers without a doubt. Boone Jenner also talked after the game last night and the Blue Jackets 5-0 loss to Washington.
You know, I don't think we played bad by any means there in the first period coming out. And, you know, the game just kind of got away from us. But we had our chance there, but a couple bounces or whatnot. But, you know, we're not too worried. You know, it's how the game works. I mean, we got another game in 2 days now, so we're just looking forward to that, and we'll shake this one off and keep rolling.
Is there a moment of appreciation for what was accomplished here?
Yeah, I think you know, obviously you look at it, and it's you know, something to be proud of, I guess, as a group. And you know, obviously just the way we've been playing, I think, you know, factors into that, and proud of that, and the results came because of that and doing the right thing. So I think we'll just you know, keep going.
You get the day off tomorrow, and then you get New York in your building on Saturday. What kind of effort do you expect will come on that ice Saturday with sort of this behind you?
Yeah, no, it's going to be a hard fought game. Obviously, it always is against the Rangers. They're a good team, and you know, coming back, having the day tomorrow just to relax, and then you know, right back at it with a divisional game. So we're just looking forward to that, and yeah.
What wasn't there tonight, or what was missing tonight that you guys have been playing well?
It's tough to just say, you know, put a finger on one thing. I think you know, a number of things goes into it, but you know, just like I said, you know, I don't think we got walked on, you know, especially in the first first few minutes of the second period there. I thought we were, you know, pressing, and you know, a couple bounces didn't go in, and he made some good saves, and you know, it's just that's how it works.
Does any part of you feel like there's some pressure that's been relieved now since the streak is finally over?
You know, it's been fun and exciting. Obviously, just keep rolling like that, and you know, obviously tonight, I guess it's It was probably the most pressure just because of the streak and or the record or whatever. But, you know, I think we've handled ourselves well. I think, you know, coaches said that, and, you know, we handled ourselves well throughout it. And, you know, it's not like, you know, anything's ending. It's game 37 or 38, I think, right now. And, you know, we just got a ways to go and where we want to get to.
And where they want to get to is to the playoffs. And at the start of today, the Blue Jackets still sit atop the Metropolitan Division with 58 points. They have a three-point lead on the Pittsburgh Penguins, a three-point lead on the New York Rangers. Washington closed the gap last night. They're only 5 points behind the Blue Jackets, although the Capitals sit in a wild card spot. Philadelphia is in the second wild card spot right now. They'll be here on Sunday, so it's not going to be an easy weekend by any means. Philadelphia has 45 points, so they're a ways back. And what Philly is starting to look at right now, they have to look over their shoulders because here come the Toronto Maple Leafs with 42 points. The Tampa Bay Lightning is right there with 42 points. And I've told you before, I think that the Lightning is going to be in when it's all said and done somehow, some way. The Carolina Hurricanes are resurgent once again. They've got 41 points. Right behind them, the Florida Panthers with 40 points. So Philadelphia, they're scrambling. And the reason they're scrambling is because after their 12-game winning streak, they have gone 1-5-2. And again, that is a very good example. If I were John Tortorella, I would go in and I would just put that number on the board. I would say, listen, the Philadelphia Flyers had a fantastic winning streak at the same time that we were streaking here, and they had 12 straight wins. And look what they have done since those 12 straight wins. They have won just one time. Two other times they got a point in an overtime loss, but they have only won one time in their last eight games. That is unacceptable. That can't happen. If that happens coming out of the 16-game winning streak, you've just basically shot yourself in the foot because now you're going to start losing ground and the other teams are going to catch up with you. How do you think the Washington Capitals felt? You know, in the last 14 games, they had gone 10-2-2. So they had picked up 22 points over the course of 14 games. And you know what happened? They went nowhere. In fact, they slid a little bit. As a matter of fact, because the Blue Jackets and the Penguins were playing so well, and the Rangers, I guess, too. I'm not so sure about the Rangers. I'll have a better feel after tomorrow night's game. But I'm just, you know, I think if there's a team in this division, and let me change that. I think of one of the top four teams. I'm not sold on Philly. I'm not sold on them. Their goaltending, I'm not sold on Philadelphia. I'm not. I'm going to tell you exactly how it is. I just did tell you. That's my feeling on them. I'm not sold on them. So if you take the top four teams, Blue Jackets, Penguins, Rangers, Capitals, I think the next one that I'm not so sold on is the New York Rangers. Now, maybe I'm completely wrong in saying that, but we'll get a better feel for it tomorrow night. But I think if there's a weak link there, I think it's the New York Rangers. You know, the Penguins are defending Stanley Cup champs. The Capitals were the President's Trophy winners. And you've got the Blue Jackets who are, you know, doing what nobody thought that they would do, but we see them play every night, and I know that they are viable, and they have the ability to play with those teams and find ways to beat those teams. The Rangers, I don't know. Like I said, I'll know more tomorrow. But I can tell you this. When you have a 16-game winning streak snapped, and you are getting into a point where, as I just said, there could possibly be a letdown, well, this, to me, is a good game. And again, I could be completely wrong. Maybe tomorrow I'm eating my words. I don't know. But I think this is a good game, and I'll tell you why. Because the Blue Jackets always get emotionally charged for games against the Rangers, the Penguins. I think the Capitals are now going to really fall into that category after what happened last night. I think they're going to be much more energized. I'm not saying they weren't energized to play them, but I don't think the Capitals fell into the same category as the Penguins and the Rangers. I think they will go into that category now. But the New York Rangers is always an easy, emotional motivation game for the Columbus Blue Jackets. So you just lost after winning 16 in a row. You're looking to regroup. You're going back home. That's a plus. You're going back home, and then you have a team coming in that you're always amped up to play against. How could that be a bad thing? Well, again, I might be eating my words tomorrow night, but I feel confident in saying that this is a good matchup for the Columbus Blue Jackets tomorrow night to get them back on track. Now, the challenge, first of all, you got to get on track. You've got to play and you've got to win against the Rangers. And then you don't even get time to sit on that because the Flyers come in the very next day. Then on Monday, you leave and you go to Carolina and you have to play a good Carolina Hurricanes team on the road on Tuesday. Then you fly to Florida And then you play the Tampa Bay Lightning, who is looking to get back into the playoff picture on Friday. Then you go across the state the very next day, and you play against the Florida Panthers. Do you understand what I'm saying here? That none of this is going to be easy. None of it. The rest of the way. This is what John Tortorella has been warning all of us about, including his players, for the last several weeks. It is going to start to ramp up, and it's going to ramp up in a big way. And we're only in January. Wait until it gets to the beginning of March. Wait until you push through the dog days of January and February and you hit the 1st of March, and all of a sudden all these teams that are out of the playoffs or they're not in the position they want to be for the playoffs start to really kick it in and gear it up and go. Then you're really going to find out what you're made of. But you've got to find out right now. All of this experience, and we've talked about it for weeks on end, about this team getting a chance to play in big games and playoff atmosphere, sell out crowds. The throng of media that was in Washington last night was very playoff-esque, and they are dealing with that now. So for those young players that haven't had that experience, they have it. What do you do with it? Once you have experience, it's up to you to decide what you're going to do with it. And that's not just individually, that's as a group. Okay, you're on the radar. I think you have a chance to slip back under the radar a little bit. On the national media front, you're going to go back under the radar because nobody's going to be leading SportsCenter talking about your streak. So you can kind of sneak back under. But for the other teams you're going to be playing, no. You're not going under their radar by any means. They are going to be out to get you every night. And especially the longer you sit at the top of that division, the longer you sit at the top of the league, you will be gunned for every single night. How will you handle it? How are you going to handle it? What are you going to do? How will you respond? Those are the questions we're about to find out about the Columbus Blue Jackets. And as great as it is to win game after game after game after game after game after game, as great as that is, the way you find the true character is now, is how they respond, how they come back, how they play, how they carry themselves, how they do all of that stuff. Now you're going to find out, because everybody's happy when you're winning. But it's when you're losing that the true character is exposed. And last year, there was some true character exposed. And some of that character is gone. And what's not gone has changed. Because the word came down from on high that it better change. And it has. So, you know, it's not the end of the world if you lose tomorrow, too. But it's going to get tighter in the race. Best case scenario is come out at home, be emotionally charged, as you always are, against the New York Rangers, and win the game. And then you can concentrate on Sunday, winning the game. Because it's got to stay the same. It's got to be the day-by-day philosophy that John Tortorella has preached, and you've gotten sick and tired of hearing throughout this winning streak. But that's what it has to be. They have to continue with that mindset. They have to continue feeling that they haven't earned the respect that they deserve. They've got to carry that chip on their shoulder throughout the entire season. I think the way you get rid of that chip is in the second week of June, when you're taking the Stanley Cup and lifting it above your head. That's the only way that you could remove that chip. You've got to play with it on your shoulder for the remainder of the year. So I think it's going to be exciting. I hated to watch them lose last night. I hated the way they lost in the second half of the game when Washington just kind of took it over. But I understand, and I've been telling you that we all know they're not going to win every game left on the schedule. And they didn't. They lost one. They lost one. So I'm not going to fret over one. If one turns into two, three, four in a row, then we will start to fret. I'm not going to worry about one. Tomorrow night, Blue Jackets and the New York Rangers, 7 o'clock, the puck drops at Nationwide Arena. By the way, you can come early. The gates are going to open at 5:30 for a 7 o'clock game. And I understand sometimes it takes a while to get into the building to get through security. So the gates will open at 5:30. The game begins at 7 o'clock. I'll be on the air tomorrow night with pregame coverage starting at 6:45. On the Blue Jackets Radio Network, which is headed up in Columbus by the flagship station, 97.1 The Fan. You can also hear the game on the NHL app. You can listen on the TuneIn app on the Blue Jackets channel, or you can go to bluejackets.com. So it's only one, and hopefully they'll make up for that tomorrow night when the Rangers come to town to take on the Blue Jackets. Until then, I'm Bob McElligott saying so long. Out of-